Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching, or silent flocks by night, behold, that blessed Christmas morn.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills.
Let's get started with some announcements.
Hey, I know sometimes I have a hard time getting in the Christmas spirit, but I know that song helps lead me the way every time. And it's just so good this time of year, this opportunity to sit down so many times with your family. And let me talk with you about this tonight. If you are new here, if you haven't been here before, if you need a way to get to know us and for us to get to know you, grab that Connect card that's in your seat, fill it out, let us know who you are. And the great thing about that is you can tell us what you're interested in, what you're looking for, but you can also turn it over on the back side and you can put your prayer request. And that's something our team takes very seriously. Every week we get together, we pray over those cards, we distribute those cards, and we try to meet any needs that you put on those cards. So use that opportunity as a family for us to communicate with one another, to know where you're at, to know what your struggles are, and to know what some of your victories are as well, because we want to share in those as well. Something else we want you to do is we want you to go to Facebook if you're a Facebooker and click like and share on tonight's sermon. It's a wonderful way for you to help somebody else to see the Word of God tonight, to hear the message of God, to hear the fact that He loves them, that He cares about them, that they're His children, and He is our great Father. And staying on the family theme, we also have potluck tonight. They mentioned it before. This is one of my favorite things that we get to do. We get to sit down with one another. We get to love on one another. We get to eat together. And breaking bread, I think, is biblical. So we're going to do that tonight right after church. And last, certainly not least here, if you sponsored a family this year for our family Christmas, your presents are due after service. If you have any questions about that, please contact Tiffany. If you don't know who Tiffany is, I'm Edward. Find me, and I will take you to Tiffany. But do this favor for me. Let's go into the word of prayer, and then let's kick off into worship. Father God, thank you for your son. Lord, thank you for every individual gathered here tonight, Lord, and watching online. I want to pray that your word would penetrate their heart, that if there's a hard spot in there, Lord, that you would soften it. If there's a struggle in their life, Lord God, that you would meet that need right where they are, and that they would know how much you care about them, Lord, and the cost that you paid for us, that we were bought at a price. And Father God, I thank you for a group of people that would come together on a beautiful Saturday night, and I want to pray that as we lift our voices up, Lord God, that you would be pleased with our praise. Christ, in your name, we give thanks for all that we have. Amen.
All right, you guys ready to worship? All right, let's get excited tonight. Get on your feet. Let's honor God tonight.
Your let's turn it up. We're gonna sing it out for all the world to hear. Oh, 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 oh. There's life for everyone. A new day has begun. Something to shout about. Let it be known that our God saves, our God reigns. We lift you up, up. Let it be known that love has come, love has won. We lift you up, up, up. Nothing can stop us now. No one can keep us down. We found our voice again. Oh, 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 oh. No need for fear and shame. There's power in His name. Come on, let freedom reign. Let it be known that our God saves, our God reigns. We lift you up, up. Let it be known that love has come, love has won.
So come.
So we wait for you. God, we wait, your good.
God in prayer right now. Bow your heads with me. Father God, we just want to honor you tonight with our praises and with our voices tonight, Lord. We pray that everyone in this place will leave changed, that we will leave with a song in our heart, with your word deep inside of us, God. We pray that you would open our ears to hear the message that you have to share with us tonight. We pray that no one would leave here without really, really delving in to what you want to share with us tonight, God. Help us to just grab a hold of your word and let it change our lives. We pray you would be with those who are hurting tonight and be with those who are struggling with difficult situations. God, we lay them all at your feet. We lay them at your cross, God, and we ask for your peace and your strength to make it through. We know that you're here for us, and we're here as a church family to lift each other up, God. Help us to give this time solely to you. Let us put aside anything that might be distracting us or causing us to stumble, Lord. This time is for you and for us to honor you, God. We love you and we praise you, Jesus. We ask all these things in your mighty name. Amen.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. And you are good, good. Oh, you are good. You're good, oh, you are good, good, oh. Let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the fire inside my gonna let me down.
sing that time. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. He is faithful. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down.
It's good to be here with you guys tonight. Why don't you turn and find somebody and introduce yourself and tell them welcome home.
Well, 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 here we are, Saturday night. How's everyone doing tonight? Yeah, okay, let's try that again. How's everyone doing tonight? All right, here are the ground rules for tonight. I'm going to preach hard and loud. The better you guys respond to God's identity, we will be out of here. We're having potluck. It's got a lot of good food tonight. If you didn't bring anything, don't worry. We have like 16 turkeys and 54 hams. We may have like five. I don't know, really. But let me tell you something right now. If you are new or fairly new, you walked in, probably someone told you, welcome home. And if they didn't, let me be the first. Welcome home. We don't say that because this is a place where individuals come to worship, but this is a place where individuals come collectively as a family to worship God together. So welcome home. Welcome to the family. Go ahead and get your Bibles out. Bibles, if you don't have a Bible, there should be a Bible on your row, or use your smart device. Go to the Bible app. It's free. Go to our app. It's free. I really don't care. Just get the word in your hand tonight. We're going to be in Luke 1:26 is where we're going to start. We're actually in a series called Advent, which is our Christmas series. Advent is actually, the Latin word is Adventus, and it means coming or arrival. And so last week we kicked it off. This week we are going to continue in, and really this time of year, Advent to us, our Christmas message, is all about hope. It's all about reflecting, looking back at why Jesus came to begin with, and remembering who he is in our heart, who he's created us to be, and not just because it's time to put up a tree and make it look pretty and get lots of presents. That's not what it's about. It's really, I want you for the next 3 weeks to really press in and ask yourself, what am I doing to live for Jesus? Where am I falling short? How can I be reminded every single day? And so that's what the next 3 weeks entails. And so how we get there will be a little bit different, because tonight I want to tell you a little something. I don't know if y'all know this, but I'm pretty excited. I didn't know if y'all knew this, but I'm a ninja. Woo, yeah, I am a list ninja. I don't, yeah, wow, right? In case you don't know, I married the master of lists. Amen. She is the queen, and she has lists left and right. They're on the refrigerator. They're in her purse. They're in two hands. They're on my front seat. They're everywhere. And I am a ninja. And I knock those lists out task after task after task. And I mean, seriously, throughout the week, it's just like, yeah, yeah. And I'm just like taking them out one by one. However, I sometimes get going a little faster than my brain allows me to go to like think through the whole situation. So sometimes I'll get a list and I won't necessarily get everything on that list because I forget the entire reason or the objective of the list to begin with, because she might say, hey, we need to go get drinks. We're having company. Go get some soda. Go get some water. Here's the list of everything else we need. So I go there, and I'm like, I'm just chopping it down one item at a time. And I come back, and she's like, where are the drinks? I'm like, but that wasn't on the list. The point is that sometimes I just get going so fast and so furious and knocking these things out that I forget the entire objective. And every time I do this, it never fails. Every time I miss an item, and I don't know why this is, I feel like I fail. Like it's a competition or a game. Because it's like, I know I'm going to go home. And it's not like, there's never been once where my wife is like, don't look at me. You know, you got to go rub your nose. You know, she's never done that before. But every single time, that's what I feel like. I feel like, oh, no, forgot the sour cream. You know, like I always feel failure. And sometimes I even get frustrated. And sometimes in our life, we do this. Not just with grocery lists, but things in life. It's like we have a plan. We have a course of action. We've even done this from the time we were small. Like we're going to go to school, and then we're going to find our sweetheart. We'll get married. We'll go to college, and then we'll find that job. We'll have kids, and they'll have kids, and everything. And we get on this course of action. We get on these plans, or we get these lists of to-dos. And sometimes we get going so fast and so furious that sometimes we forget the objective of why we're doing them to begin with. But we feel like we need to get these done. We need to get these done. And when it doesn't happen just the way we want it to, it leaves us empty. It leaves us frustrated. It leaves us feeling like failure sometimes. But here's the deal. Sometimes God throws a curveball. Sometimes he throws a curveball, and it doesn't matter how great you are, how good you are at your job, how great your marriage you think it is. Sometimes God throws a curveball, and he interrupts my plans, which is very difficult because I have it together. Like, I know what I need to do. I mean, I know how to get from point A to point B, and I know every little task in between. And if I don't, my wife will remind me because she, again, is the queen of lists. And it's my job to make sure we get there because the household of the Phippses, we need to, our status quo is like we need to knock these things out in order to get things done. But here's the deal. When God throws us a curveball, it's not about your list or your objective. It's more about his purpose. And I'm not just talking about the grocery list anymore. And we're going to look at Luke in 1:26 today. It's the foretelling of the birth of Jesus. Now, this is a much bigger scope here. We're talking about Mary and Joseph, the parents of Jesus, because their life is not very different than our life. They had something planned. They had something lined out. They had their to-do lists, but then God threw a curveball. Let's go ahead and look in verse 26. In the sixth month, angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. So let's talk about the vitals of the situation before we dig any further. Basically, you have Mary and Joseph. They're from a one-well town, which means it would have been very small. In fact, the number of people in this entire church building tonight would have represented probably what Nazareth would have been. So one-well town, it means that well would have had to sustain about, you know, however many people that was. It's probably 100, 150 people. So you have a young Mary who's probably around 12, 13, 14 years of age. And you have Joseph who's probably in his later teens. And they have an angel, Gabriel. There's two angels that the Bible talks about. This is one of them, and he always brings and delivers a message. So he's bringing the word to Mary. And so you have this young teenager, this young male teenager. They're from a town, of a small town, and you know that what's going to happen. Oh my gosh, did you hear that Mary's pregnant? I can already hear it now, and the struggles that would have already been coming to her mind just in the first few moments. It says they were betrothed to one another. That's like an engagement, but it's legally bound. It's a little bit more important. It's not like you could just walk away from one another. There were severe implications to her being pregnant and being a virgin. She could have been stoned to death. I mean, the repercussions from this would have been dire. It would have been, oh, I can't even exaggerate it enough. But they had a plan. Think about this. They're from a small town that they probably, their families knew each other. They were betrothed to one another at a young age. They plan on getting married. They probably, you know, doing the job thing and the family thing and having kids, as many as they can. And then in a brief second, an angel appears and says, no, that's not exactly how it's going to work out. And some of us in life, I know some of us in this room tonight, you're sitting there, you're like, I had a plan, but now I'm so far off course, I don't know what to do. You know, maybe it was the sickness that came in, and like it interrupts your entire living. Like everything that you think you know and everything that you're aiming for is wiped away, or it feels like it's just taken from you. Or maybe it's a job, especially in this time of season, you're like, you're stressed out, you're worried, how am I going to pay for this, pay for that, how are the kids going to have presents? Maybe it's a death in the family. Maybe it's every single year you have that void in your life, and every time Christmas comes around, you just think, oh. The holidays are painful. And you're no longer on that trajectory. You're no longer on that path that you feel like God is going to take you. And here's Mary and Joseph going, what is going on? Let's go on to verse 30. It says, and the angel said to her, do not be afraid. That's super important. We'll come back to that. Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And by the way, earlier he says, oh, favored one, which just means that she's full of grace. It's like he came down and said, you are the one that has been chosen, you who are gracious and full of love. And he's telling her, he's like, hey, don't be worried. Don't be scared. I mean, could you imagine someone going, hey, guess what? You're fired. Your life is going to be turned upside down. But don't worry. Don't be scared. Because you have the favor of God. I mean, could you imagine how scary this must have been? Let alone it's an angel. I mean, I think we skip over the story and go, well, yeah, it is the Bible. I mean, have any of you been met by an angel? I mean, let alone do you have a teenager that's 13 years old that you'd be comfortable with? Like, you don't even feel comfortable buying them a phone, let alone let them, you know, marry someone and be pregnant. Could you imagine how scary this time must be in their life? And I know in your life right now, you might be scared. Even how others think of us. Because you know they're already whispering, how did she get pregnant? Why is Joseph still with her? You know, her reputation would have been tarnished from the get-go, let alone her husband's. We don't talk about that. Everything that he must have gone through and that she must have gone through, even from the very beginning, to know that there are going to be people pointing the fingers, talking behind their back, and just like it is today, it's no different today than when we walk through those doors and we see someone that's been doing something that we don't approve of, yet we have no control over, but we like to talk and point and poke and say, look at that. Why aren't you doing it like the Bible says, even though it's not your life? You know, she's a virgin, really? I mean, could you imagine? She's like, I swear it was an angel. I swear. And I am carrying the Son of God. What? Could you imagine what she must have been going through? In fact, the angel said, do not be afraid. Now, did you know that in the Bible, the most frequently used command there is do not be afraid? It's also known as fear not, do not be afraid. Over 350 times in the Bible alone, God uses this command to us. Do not be afraid. And what do you think that is? I think it's because our lives become easily riddled with stress and fear and anxiety and worry, no matter what we're going through. I mean, our world is programmed to react to our stress and our worries. And the way we feel, everything from the commercials to marketing to jobs, everything that's sold in this world, everything that's worldly, is geared around the way we feel. Do not fear. What happens is when fear grips the mind, worry overtakes the body. When fear grips the mind, worry takes over the body. And what I mean is, it's like you start to break down, you start to lose sleep. Or some of us start to self-medicate. We start to eat too much. We start to drink too much. We work too much. Everything in excess or not enough. And we're not doing the things that we need to do to be healthy. But we need to realize that God is there every step of the way. In fact, when I hear it as a command, I feel it's rigid. Like, don't be scared. It doesn't feel like, that doesn't do anything for me. And don't look at it as a command. Don't. I encourage you, look at it as an invitation. When God says, don't be afraid, I always picture him like, don't be afraid, like, get up, what's wrong with you? But that's not how it is. Remember, we serve a relational God, a God so much so that he wants to sit down beside you, put his arm around you, and say, it's okay, don't be scared, I'm here. I liken it to this. Do any of you have children who have been nightmares in the middle of the night? And you walk, amen. You walk in and you don't know what's going on, but you know they're scared out of their mind. And so you sit down and you've never once gone in there and be like, stop it. Don't be afraid. What is wrong with you? No, we don't do that. Why? Because it doesn't work. What we do is I sit down with my daughter and I sit down with her and I caress her and I say, hey, don't be afraid. It's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. And I put my arm around her and I start to connect with her. And what it is it's not the words, do not be afraid, that soothes her. It's my presence. And so when God is saying, do not be afraid, fear not, what he's actually saying is, I've got you. I have not left you. I am right here. Listen to my words. Feel my presence. How many times in life we get frustrated, we get mad, we get angry, we get sad, we're scared out of our mind, we have so much fear riddled through our bodies that we've lost control. We're like, where is God? It's because we're not listening to him. We're not accepting that invitation. Fear not. Remember, we have a relational God, and he loves you. God's presence is the answer to our worry. God's presence is the answer to our worry. So when you get out of control and life is going crazy, think about this angel and what he said to Mary. He said, listen, I know things are going to be bad. And you're going to hurt. But don't be afraid. I can almost picture his love just beaming off of him and his face dripping with grace and putting his arm around her and saying, child, I love you. God loves you. It's going to be rough, but I'm going to be right here no matter what you're going through, the sickness, the job, the hurt, the worry, the stress. As we start to live in fear, we do. We start to live in fear and we worry and we start to lose faith. And what we do is we start to trust out here by sight where Mary and Joseph were looking through faith. See, we start to trust by sight. Oh, I can only, as far as I can see it. Whereas Mary and Joseph, they're like, okay, what do we need to do? And they're looking through faith. We get so frustrated and so riddled with fear that stress and worry, anxiety starts to riddle our bodies and it breaks us down. Accept that invitation of do not be afraid. Let's go on to verse 31. It says, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, right? God with us, Emmanuel. And what it's doing is it's fulfilling Isaiah 7:14. It's fulfilling prophecy. He's calling all this out right now. In verse 32, he says, he will be great and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. So basically he's saying, listen, he is coming, Jesus is coming, you don't understand, the Son of God, I am going to use you, God is going to use you to fulfill his purpose. And here's what Mary responds with, how will this be? I am a virgin. How is this going to happen? And it makes me think, okay, the angel's like fired up. I can almost picture like, this is what's going to happen. The whole world is going to be changed. Your life, your life, your life, my life, your life. All of us are going to be changed. And she's like, yeah, I don't know. How is that going to work with what I have going on? Because this is not going to end well for me. And there's nothing wrong with asking questions to God. There's not. But we have to be prepared to not get the answer that we desire sometimes. When we start to live for his purpose and live for his will, we have to understand that his purpose is greater than our plans. His purpose is greater than our plans. And it's okay to ask questions, but we have to start to follow God and not follow our feelings, which is hard because his will doesn't feel good sometimes. His will doesn't feel good sometimes. I mean, there's been plenty of times in my life I'm like, I don't want to do this. I'm sure there's been plenty of times with us right here, like, I don't want to be here tonight. I don't want to talk to anyone. I don't want people to love on me and show me the love of Christ. I don't want to reciprocate what God is giving me willingly because it doesn't feel good. But we have to learn how to follow his will and not follow our emotions. I mean, we start to doubt if God is even with us. I mean, 3 years ago this month, I'll tell you a quick story. 3 years ago this month, my marriage was flipped upside down. I didn't know. Forget about ministry. I didn't know if I was going to be married the next day. I got some news that rocked my world, and I'm like, okay, God, where are you at now? Where are you at now? And what had happened was, is it starts 3 years previous to this. My wife and I, we feel called by God to start a ministry. Not only that, I mean, I change vocation. I go from working to starting to be called into the church full time, and I'm doing this, and my wife is excelling in her job. A ministry takes off. I'm working for a church. I got my list. Yes, yes, and I'm waking up, I'm rocking it, man. She's rocking it. And for 3 years, man, I feel like we are obeying God. We are step in step with each other. We are headed the right direction. Like, we're in God's will, obviously. Fast forward 3 years, I'm sitting in my office with my boss. I go home to my wife. And what I had done is I had allowed my checklist. The objective, I had forgotten the objective. The reasons behind the list of God's will, of what I've been called to do. No, it had just become a checklist. It's just one more thing on the way to fast track to success. This is what I'm doing. And it was tangible. That's the great thing about lists, is, man, I can see my progress. And the world won't slow you down. If anything, they'll encourage you and speed you up. And God had been showing me signs, slow down. It even started changing my heart from the ministry and the church I was in, saying, what about this? And I was like, it's not on the list, not on the list. And what I had done is I had broken my promise to my wife and to God to make her priority number two next to God. And during this time, an old wound of my wife's had opened back up. And I was too busy to notice it. But another man had not. So here I am, 3 years ago this month. I'm broken. I step away from church. I'm like, I got to get my family in order. I got to get my family in order. Forget this list. And I throw the list down, and I realize for the first time in about at least a year that, man, none of this matters. Seek God. Seek God. Dwell in Him. Trust in Him. That was not anywhere on my radar. And what I had done is I had plans. And God was trying to show me for months, hey, no, this way. And I was like, get off me. I've got a job to do. And what's crazy is that we can go through these motions and we can go through these tasks in our lives, whether it's your job, your family, you know, a death, whatever it is, we start to get in this routine where we become callous. And we can't hear God, but we pretend that we can. And God's word is pointing you in a direction, but you don't want to listen to it because you haven't opened it. Because you have a list, and we forget the objective. What is God's will? He threw me this curveball. It doesn't feel good. Where are you at now, God? And I hurt as bad as I've ever hurt in my life. And I was in a situation where nothing made sense. I'm like, my ministry is doing well. Things around me are going great. How is God in this? How can God be in a situation where it has ripped my heart out? Where my wife is hurt beyond anything she can explain to me. And because of my lack of presence, I have no idea what's going on. And I had more questions than I had answers. And I'd been so far knocked off my plan that I was in uncharted territory. Like, where do I go? And I know some of you are like right there right now. You're like, I'm there. I don't know what to do. Like, I'm right there in the middle of the ocean. I've been knocked out of the ship. I've been knocked out of the boat. And I'm right there with you. I don't know where God is at. Where's he at now? And this verse kept coming to me, Romans 8:28. It just kept, I didn't want to read it, and I read it, and I said, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. No. Let's read that again. It works together for good, not for our good. All right, let's not get that confused, because I was thinking, this is not working for me. But that's not what the word says. It says it's working for good for those who are called according to his purpose. Listen, God will use my pain. What he couldn't allow was my disobedience. What he couldn't allow was my wife's disobedience. But my pain he can handle. And what he was trying to say is like, my purpose is bigger than your plans. My purpose is bigger than your plans. Too many times in life we get knocked down and we're like, forget it. Like, what are the chances of me getting back on that fast track? Or like, man, I knew what God called me to do, and now I'm so far away from it. We get so distracted. We get so upset. We get like, I'll never make it again. Listen, maybe God's purpose in your life is so much bigger that you can't even see it. You are so consumed with what's right there in front of you. Get it out of the way. I had to be stripped completely bare. Almost lost my marriage. The first thing we did was we repented. We took it to the church and said, this is what we've done. What do we do? Because I'd been talking to God, it felt like, and he wasn't answering me. I went and sought some counsel from people. God will use people to help heal people. And it comes in the unlikeliest of people, too. People start showing up and you're like, oh, okay, there's God. There he is. He is here. He sends you a couple that like, who are these people? And how did, like, why is their story exactly like mine? Listen, God's purpose is more important than our plans. The fact of the matter is this. If I would have been obedient earlier, maybe it would have stopped things. It doesn't matter now. It doesn't matter. I wouldn't change a thing. And the reason why is until I was obedient, until we are both obedient, until we were both stripped down to our core, to the bare, just to nothing, I wasn't letting God in my heart. In fact, I was telling people that, and I thought I was because I was on this list, knocking it out. But sometimes, we need to remember the objective. Just like when I forget something on my list, God, it doesn't matter. What matters is the heart behind what we're doing. Is it God's purpose or is it our plans? Let's go on to verse 35. He said, and the angel answered her. He said, listen, let me calm you down here. The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, a child to be born will be called holy, the Son of God. He's saying, Jesus is coming. Salvation is coming. He is about to arrive, and God is going to use you, a teenager, the most unlikely of people. And I'm like, now, like, when I read this story now, I'm like, yeah, that could be me. That could be you. Because she was so caught up in the how and the why, and he said, don't focus on the how or the why. Focus on the what. And the what is salvation. What is eternity. What is good news. Whatever's bothering you, shake it off. I've got something for you, and it's called hope, and it's called love, and it's called faith. It's called a whole new life if you want it. Focus on the what. You know, if God will use a teenager to fill his purpose, he'll use a broken down mid-30s man. Closer to 40, but whatever. Verse 37, for nothing will be impossible with God. I serve a God so big, there is nothing. And listen, my small brain, we have a God that knows exactly what's going on in my heart at the same time he knows what's going on in your heart. Don't ask me to explain that. I don't need to. He's God. My job is to preach and teach and to equip you, to encourage you, to let you know there is good news, and let you know that if you have fallen off the fast track, if you've fallen off your to-do list, it's okay. Because more than likely, he's ready to use you for his purpose and not for your plans. For nothing will be impossible with God. And Mary said, behold. I like this. She's like, how is this going to happen? And then she says, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And then the angel left her. Write this down. I love this. God provides the results if we provide the faithfulness. God provides the results if we provide the faithfulness. And that means whenever you get knocked down, that means whenever, you know, everything is lost and that relationship is broken and you think, how is my marriage going to last, let alone my job, my family, my schooling, finances, what am I going to do? And nothing is impossible for our God. He will provide the results, but we have to be okay with the results aren't for our plans, but for his purpose. Don't lose sight of that. And so just because we need to have a little bit of application here, let's talk about this real quick. We'll wrap it up with this. How do we remain faithful when God changes our plans? Because when he interrupts us, it's not convenient. No one likes the thought of starting over. It cripples most of us, like the fear of like, I'm going to have to do something else with my life. The only thing I've known was this for the last 30 years. And the first one is this. And it's got nothing to do with your ability to work. It's got everything with your ability to get into this. You've got to know the word. Because before you can believe the word, you've got to know the word. And I'm not just talking about Romans 8:28 and John 3:16. In Psalm 23, I'm not just talking about the ones that you hear over and over and over again, the ones that you read on Facebook continuously, on Instagram continuously. I'm talking about the ones that God sends you that says, you need to read this in order for your life to start making sense, or maybe not even making sense, but understand my purpose and not your plans. And so you've got to know the word, because in order to believe the word, you've got to know the word. The second one is this, is you've got to trust God. And once you know the word, you can start to trust the word, which is trusting in God. And you got to trust his purpose is way better than my plans. I mean, I trust God a lot more with my life than I do with me in control of it. I mean, I've tried, and I've almost wrecked my marriage probably a dozen times and brought down, I mean, like, I can't do this. Only he can do this. The third thing is this, is we have to accept that we may lose something. What did this cost Joseph? What did this cost Mary? To be faithful, to be obedient, to be interrupted by God and be used by his purpose, reputation, their entire life. But they were willing to stand there and say, behold, I am your faithful servant. Whatever I got to do. When was the last time that you said yes to God when he asked you to do something? Where is God using you? How is he speaking to you? How is he telling you right now you need to believe this, but yet you don't want to hear it? Don't be like me. For 3 years, I was on a fast track, and all I did was separate myself from God and from my family. Humble yourself. Hey, don't wait for God to strip it all away from you. Strip it all away yourself. Humbly, every single day. Get on your knees and pray to him. Get on your knees. It's not for you. It's for him. You know, he doesn't need that, but you know what? It shows that you're humble. And we need a good reminder. Every single day we should start our days off like this. We have to accept that living for the kingdom, which means living kingdom up, not culture up, which is what we're doing. We live culture up and then kingdom down. That's not the way it works. It's kingdom up, culture down, which means eternity thinking, kingdom minded. That means that whatever you're going through, hey, keep your eye on the prize. It's hard to do when you lose a job, when you lose a loved one, whenever your marriage is in shambles. How do I stay focused and stay positive on the Lord? Is that you have to change your entire lifestyle. The last one is this, is you have to deny your desires. This is picking up your cross daily. This is laying your feelings at the foot of the cross and not buckling them up to ride shotgun with you everywhere you go. Because it's a lot easier to, like, just pull out a feeling real quick and put it in your bow and shoot it at someone than it is to say, okay, I give it to you, God. I give it to you, God. And what happens is when we start to live in our feelings more than we do in his purpose, is that maybe some of those things that go on in your life, because we get so focused on other things, maybe God's trying to get your attention. Listen, he didn't make me do the things I did. He didn't make my wife do that. We did those on our own. But he didn't stand in the way. He said, oh, you don't want to be in my will? I give humble to the grace, not to the proud. You think you got it? I'll let you have it. And we get in these situations where we feel like we might be lost. I mean, I feel like this weekly. Sometimes I feel like I'm drowning. Like, it might just be because of laundry. You know what I mean? Like, I get overwhelmed, and I just, like, what am I going to do? Like, how am I going to get up on that horse again? I've been knocked off, and I don't know how we're going to tackle this. I don't even know how we're going to pay for these things. And I surely don't know how I'm going to win my wife back, my husband back. I don't know how we're going to deal with this health issue. Because it's hard. And it's not easy. And people expect things. Get those people out of your head. Get them out of your life. Those that tell you, well, you got to do it this way, or they're always nay, and they're going to tell you that, could be worse. Listen, that's the worst thing we could say. Well, at least, are you kidding me? I don't know what you're going through. I don't pretend to, but God does. I sit here and go, God, what was the point of everything that I had to go through 3 years ago? I still don't know some of it, and he's still revealing it to me one piece at a time. But God had a plan. Because without everything that happened, we wouldn't be in this church today. I tell you that. If I would have been obedient early, I don't think it would have happened. If things didn't happen the way they did, I don't know if it would have happened. It doesn't matter. I'm not going to look back and go, if, shoulda, woulda, coulda. I'm just going to count my blessings and say, thank you, Lord. Behold, I am your faithful servant. I don't like the way it feels, but I promise you this, if you don't like the way it feels, if you just have a little bit of breath in your lungs, he's going to give you purpose for your soul. Okay? I mean, you got to keep fighting. If you're broken, you're hurt, maybe you're just lonely. Man, he's providing you a place to come hear some good news. Now go get plugged in the rest of the week. Don't carry hate and animosity with you everywhere you go, because life isn't like where you think it should be. Very rarely did we become, who here is an astronaut? Anybody? One person in the back, great. We do have a group for liars, sir. But very rarely do our plans work out the way we want them to. Like, we all wanted to be this, this, and this when we grow up, but we're sitting here and we all have different paths and different trajectories, and God's purpose is working through all of us. Here's the way I like to look at it. If God can use Mary and Joseph, he can use you. Because he didn't use the rich, he used the poor. He didn't use the mighty, he had used the fallen. He didn't use the righteous, he uses the broken. And that's good news, because you know what? It makes starting over less fearful. Like, you know what? Christmas might be different this year because I lost my father. Christmas might be different this year because I've lost a job. Christmas might be different this year because we're dealing with something as a family. But he will use us nonetheless, and we start focusing on the right things, on his return, because he's coming again. Guess what? He's coming again. And he is arriving. He will use you. You think that your plans are mightier than his purpose? Guess again, God will choose you, but you have to allow him into your heart. Kingdom thinking, constant prayer and communication about your situation. Seek counsel, press in. One thing I've learned is that God may not get you out of the situation, but he will walk with you through the situation. He will walk with you through the situation. And one last thing, if you're waiting on a message from God, like sometimes I catch myself, I'm like, all right, God is going to speak to me. I'm waiting for you. I'm meditating. And sometimes it doesn't come. I'm like, where are you? Like, what's going on? Because my timing's not always in step with God. And I'm waiting on God to send me a message. But here's the deal. What Mary and Joseph did, they weren't waiting for a message. They were living for God and not waiting on God. And so don't use that as an excuse. You're sitting here like, well, I'm just going to wait until God shows me a word, and it's been 38 years. Start living for him so he can start to use you in his purpose. You've got to get outside of yourself. I mean, if your list isn't working, get rid of it. God is going to provide you a new list, and it's going to be for his purpose. Don't lose sight of that. Don't lose sight. It's like right now, some of us just need to scrap it. Just need to take it. We're done. Like, I don't need this anymore. What I've got is this. He will show me, and if he doesn't show me, I'm going to ask someone else how they did it. And maybe God will start to show me when I start to seek counsel. And whenever I start to go and do the right things that God wants me to do, maybe he'll reveal that what I thought was my purpose, it wasn't my purpose to begin with. Maybe my purpose is just to humbly submit daily. I'm still trying to figure out what I want to do when I grow up. You know? I just pray every single day that I get to just to read his word and just to be humble enough to go, you know what? I don't even understand what this means really. But I'm going to study it. And I'm going to share with you what it says to me. And you should share with someone else what it says to you. And if your plans aren't the way like you thought they're going to turn out, that's okay. His purpose is greater than your plans. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for pouring life into us and readjusting us when we get so focused on the task and the to-dos, and we start to lose sight of what it is you've given us to do, which is live a life glorifying you in all we do. And God, some of us, we haven't glorified you in a long time. We haven't. We haven't stepped up to the plate. We haven't submitted everything at the cross, but now we're ready, God. Maybe it was this week, or it was last month, or maybe it was even today that you just felt like God wasn't with you. But guess what? God's presence is with us. And God, we are thankful for your presence. And right now, we want that presence back in our hearts. And some of us here, we've never even given our life to have his presence with us. We've never asked him for forgiveness. We've never asked him to step in and to become the king of our hearts, to sit on the throne of our hearts. And I'm going to give you a chance right now with every head bowed and every eye closed. Whether you've fallen away from him and you're ready to come back, or for the very first time, you're ready to give your heart over to Jesus. If that's you right now, I want you to just raise your hand up. I want you to raise your hand up. God is ready to make a difference in all of our lives. We just have to submit it to him. God, thank you so much for forgiving us. Thank you for the blood of your son, for washing us clean, for making us new, for taking away my old list and giving me a new purpose. Thank you for knocking me off my high horse and giving me a new course, a course to glorify you in all that we do. God, we ask you right now into our hearts. We thank you for that forgiveness. We thank you for your son who died for us. We thank you in his holy name. And everybody said, amen. Go ahead and stand to your feet. Let's worship one more time before we go eat. If you made a decision today or if you just need some prayer, there's like a ton of people in the back. We want to pray for you. We want to talk to you. We want to help you walk through this next season.
Heart abandoned for more of you.
life surrender, my heart abandon for more of you. My soul devotion, my only focus to worship you. My life surrendered, my heart abandoned for more of you.
Hey, what a wonderful night, and it's always something special whenever you hear just unbelievable transparency. And there's not a slide for this, but I wanted to give a plug to our groups. If you need a group, if you need a place where you can be transparent, come to our main campus, 500 East Main, almost every day of the week. Find a group. Find someone to get involved with. Find some accountability. Find someone to help you grow in where you are. Something else we have going on this week is we have Courageous Kids training. I'm sorry, it's not this week. It's after service on 1218, there will be CK training. If you currently serve or would like to know more about serving Courageous Kids, this is your opportunity. It will be from 7:30 to 8:15, and dinner is provided for that training. Something else we're doing here is we're doing One Christmas. We believe that God, he's not coming back for a harem. He's coming back for a bride. And sometimes we draw so many lines in the sand between us and them. We're going to be combining church with Canadian Valley for that one service. We'll be celebrating Christmas this year as one church. Saturday night, Pastor Cameron will preach, and we will have candlelight service. The following morning, John will preach, and we will take communion as one body of believers. And that's just a great way for churches to come together and say, we're in this together. We're fighting the same fight against the same enemy for the same souls that we're trying to win to the Lord. So I encourage everybody here to be a part of One Christmas. I also want to mention John Ward is still up for deaconship as part of our policy. We mentioned this 2 weeks in a row. This is week number two. If you have any questions, concerns, you want to get to know who he is, there's a great opportunity to give him a call and say, hey, man, I just want to know who you are. You know, if you're going to be part of our pastoral care, I'd like to know you. So do that. Get a hold of John Ward. If you have any questions, you can also contact the office. If you're not comfortable calling John personally, but he's an incredible guy, so I encourage everyone here who doesn't know him to get to know John. I also wanted to mention Coffee and Canvas was absolutely incredible last week. So many people came out and dedicated their time. Yeah, absolutely. And 30 people came and painted in one shape, form, fashion, or another. 30 people came to the Good Fight Church, our main campus over there on 500 East Main Street. 30 people got to be prayed over, loved on, ministered to. People say the most incredible things. One of my favorite things I heard was, this is just what my wife and I needed. We needed to sit down and not think about anything else for an hour and a half, but enjoying each other's company. And that's what we got out of Coffee and Canvas. So it's touching lives, and it's incredible. And as a side bonus, it's raising money for building funds, which brings us to our next point here. If you're ready to write that tithe check, if you're old school like me and you still use a check, maybe you're a little bit more modern and you use the app, the website, the square in the back, the text to give, whatever it is. Just remember, we have two things. We have tithe and then we have building fund. You could denote on there which one it is. But either way, we appreciate it, and it means a lot to the church family, everything that you guys do. And we know it's an incredible sacrifice that you make. Do me this favor. Before we run into potluck, let's bow our heads and pray for this week. Father God, we ask that you would go before us this week. That your heart would be our heart, Lord God, that your love would be our love, that we would be a light in this world, Lord God, that we would shine in this world, that we would push back the darkness with your strength and your power, Father God, and that you would give us wisdom, Lord, you would give us words, you would give us the right actions at the right time to have an impact and let the world know that you've changed our lives, and God, you want to change their lives as well. Father, we thank you for a chance to come together as a family for potluck. I want to pray for that meal right now, Lord God, that you would bless that food to nourish our body, that you would bless the hands that have prepared it, that you would bless our time together as a family, Father God. And let us enjoy this special time to sit down with one another and share and get to know that person across the table from us, Lord, or get to know that family we have never sat next to. Father God, we thank you for potluck, and we thank you for our church family. Christ, in your name we give thanks. Amen. Hey, guys, thank you for coming out tonight. Join us for potluck. It's going to be delicious. And tell someone this week how great God is.